I'm excited to finish up our sermon series streaks. Come on, you guys have been enjoying sermon series streaks. Learning how to have consistency in the right things and the things that matter. And with that being said, I just want to pray over tonight because I believe God is about to bust the lid off of your guys' potential when it comes to consistency and setting the right streak. So let's pray really quick. Dear Lord, I thank you for every single student that has stepped into this room, Lord. This is not just any Wednesday, God. This is your Wednesday. This is a Wednesday where they're going to recharge, Lord, but they're not just going to do it here, God. They're going to take it into their school, God. And they're going to create consistent streaks in their life that matter and that work towards you, God. In Jesus' name we all say, amen, amen. You guys, I'm going to be talking about time and resources tonight. How many of you guys know that we are a little streaky when it comes to commitment, when it comes to time? We're so scared to commit to something because we're afraid something else better is along down the road. All right, but we're going to be talking about committing to the investment that God has put into us, that he has invested time and he's gifted us with us, gifted us resources, he gifted us time, and we are going to own up to that. We're going to put some work into that. With that being said, I want to talk about a story really quick about seventh grade. Many of you guys may have heard this story, maybe not. I actually haven't shared this one for a while. But in the seventh grade, I was kind of your hormonal boy, and I was starting to like girls at the time. Kim, don't get mad at me. I'm sorry. I was in seventh grade. I didn't know you. But I was starting to like girls at the time, and there was this cute girl in my gym class. So every fifth period, I was super stoked about gym class because I got to see Ali Mahacek. And it's kind of weird now that we have a YouTube channel. I hope she doesn't watch this because that'd be a little awkward. But it was seventh grade, and you know, I always loved to try to be on like the opposite team of her because I knew that she would get to chase me in the game, and we would tag each other, and we would flirt and all that stuff. Come on, guys, you know, you taking some tips, take some notes. And that's just what I did. I mean, I was a flirt in seventh grade, kind of a bit of a tool. And so it was Friday fun day. We're playing Capture the Flag. All right, and so that's a perfect game where I get to chase this cute girl. And so we're playing Capture the Flag. I'm guarding the hoop where the flag's in, and then all of a sudden I see Allie run across from the opposite team coming and try to grab my flag. I'm like, okay, go ahead, you grab it. And she grabs the flag. I start chasing her. I'm like so pumped because I'm just getting to like chase this girl that I think's cute. My face is grinning and my mouth's wide open. I'm like, yeah, I'm gonna get her. And all of a sudden my friend Jake jumps out in front of her about to take her. She stops on a dime, turns around, and smack, I run right into her forehead. My teeth come straight out, right? My two front teeth are completely fake, okay? My two front teeth come straight out. Jake picks them up and goes, here's your teeth. And I'm like, oh, thanks, Jake. I appreciate that. Thanks for my teeth. That day, they put them back in at the dentist. I had to walk to the dentist. It was a block away. And they put them back in. Those teeth lasted 5 years. So this is the worst part about it all, all right? Besides the whole seventh grade thing and Allie, we never really worked out. She ended up dating some other guy, whatever. She missed out. She missed out on that toothless bum, me. But anyways, I get to my senior year, and I'm playing a basketball game, and I get elbowed in my teeth. And they basically get knocked out again. And so here I am, my senior year, and I'm super bummed, right? Because this is my senior year. I'm super pumped. I'm that athlete. I got to keep my appearance up. I got to be cool. Well, now I'm going to look like an idiot walking around with no front teeth my senior year. Because before, they put them back in right away. It wasn't like I ever missed them. So I get to my senior year. I'm taking like my senior photos with no front teeth. Man, I looked like a clown. It was a disaster. And I remember I was starting to get so depressed at one point. And I'm like, I don't even want to go outside the house, Dad. I was talking to my mom. I was talking to my dad. I don't even want to go out the house anymore. And my dad's like, he asked me these two questions. He's like, well, Josh, do you have cancer? And I'm like, well, no. He goes, are you in a wheelchair? I'm like, no. I'm like, okay, that's good perspective. I think I need to own up and get back to being myself. I think I need to start giving value back to the people and my friends. And I got to stop just being such a downer and wasting my time and wasting my resources by hiding away. So I just own this no tooth thing. You can ask, there might be a picture back here. That's what I looked like. Come on. I owned it, you guys. I was happy to be alive. I won senior class clown. Come on. All right, I had one friend, he thought I was so cool. He's like, man, you're the nicest and happiest no-tooth person I've ever met. And I'm like, what does that even mean? And then I started to think about people that don't have teeth. I think about pirates, and you have people out of prison, and boxers. And I'm like, all right, those are pretty angry, crabby people. I'm like, okay, that makes sense. But I'll take it. And the whole point of that story is that if we don't own up to our situation, own up to our circumstances, and just own it, and just have fun in it and be ourselves and just be like, hey, I got a job to do. I got to go out there and I have value to give. And I got to own, like I said, own my situation and give value to others. If I would have just hid away, no one would have got to experience the class clown my senior year. And so I want to elaborate on this whole idea a little bit. We're going to be talking about the parable of the talents. Who's ever heard of the parable of the talents? A couple of us. Leaders have. Kelsey, you heard about it? Come on. Who knows what a parable is? Anybody? Come on, leaders. Well, a parable is a story that explains a simple lesson. Jesus loved using stories. He was so creative in his communication. And he loved using stories to explain simple lessons. And so what the parable, the NIV calls it the parable of the bags of gold, right? A talent is just basically a currency. It's like money. The parable of the bag of gold, what he was trying to explain through this parable is that God is like an investor that invests in us, right? He gives us resources, the fact that we have a body, all this kind of stuff, it all comes from God. And he's explaining this in a story of how he invested in the three men. And we're going to read it. Who's got their Bible today? Can we open up our Bible to Matthew chapter 25, verse 14? I'll give you guys 3 seconds to get there. 3, 2, 1. Joey, are you there? What are you doing? Come on, pull that Bible. Here we go. We're going to read it. You guys can, we got a jumbo Bible on the back here, so you guys can check that out. Verse 14, it says, again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. Everyone's saying entrusted. To one he gave 5 bags of gold, to another 2 bags, and to another 1 bag, each according to his ability. Then he went on his journey. The man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 bags more. So also the one with 2 bags of gold gained 2 more, but the man who had received 1 bag went off. He dug a hole. Everyone say, dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received 5 bags of gold brought the other 5. Master, he said, you entrusted me with 5 bags of gold. See, I have gained 5 more. His master replied, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. God goes on to say the same thing, or the master goes on to say the same thing with the guy with 2 bags, and he rewards them. We'll get to the guy with 1 bag in a little bit. But we have to understand that God is an investor, right? Everyone take a deep breath really quick. Breathe in, breathe out. Breathe in, breathe out. We're doing aerobics now, right? But the fact that you are breathing right now is saying, God says that you're not dead, I'm not done with you. That I see that you have value, I see that you are profitable, that you guys have value to give, you have something to do, you can multiply the goodness of God, right? No one in here has the right to say, no one has faith in me. Man, just nobody believes in me, nobody has that right, because the fact that we're breathing, the fact that God created you, shows that he is investing in you and he's giving you something, right, Joey? Come on, can I get an amen? Amen, amen. Come on. I got a couple, there we go. But God believes in you, guys. God has faith in you. And it got me thinking a little bit about Justin Bieber, okay? Who's seen his documentary, Never Say Never? Maybe some, you've heard it, you've seen it. And what I love about this documentary, we so often think like Justin Bieber, they were just so naturally talented, right? We think that they just came out of the womb and they're just singing lullabies to themselves, right? They just have this beautiful voice. But the greats actually have more coaches than anybody. And I love watching this documentary because it was talking about Justin Bieber's vocal coach, and she was very prestigious. She worked with people like Drake and Usher, and Justin was very young in his musical career, and he had to basically really show this vocal coach that he valued what she put into him. And she's like, Justin, if I'm going to teach you, if I'm going to coach you, you have to put in the action steps and put in what I tell you to show me that you value what I'm telling you. The advice that I'm giving you, you have to put it into action. You have to put it out there and you have to do it. Otherwise, I'm not going to give you the time of day, right? And that's the same thing with God. I think about when I meet with Pastor Jordan or when I meet with Pastor CJ and I'm talking about my marriage with them. I'm talking about, you know, being in ministry, whatever it may be. I am so quick to want to put into action what they tell me because I value their time. I value their time. Just think of someone right now that is just awesome and amazing. And if you got time with them for like 10 minutes, what would you do? What would you show? You probably want more time with them. You want to show them that you value their time. And so that's the same thing with God, that we have to show him that we value his time, okay? And I think we have some great life lessons that we can learn from these guys that had the money bags. The first one I'm going to call 5 bags. I'm just going to call them 5 bags. So the guy that had 5 bags, I'm going to call him 5 bags. The guy that had 2 bags, I'm going to call him 2 bags. And the guy that had 1 bag, I'll call him 1 bag. So when you hear me say them, refer to them like that, you'll know who I'm talking about. But I think we can learn a quick lesson here from five bags. You see, five bags, what did he do so well? We read it. He was urgent. He knew that there was value of God. He knew the value of God, and he knew that he needed to work fast. I want to read this verse one more time to you. It says this, verse 16. The man who had received five bags of gold went at once and put his money to work and gained five bags more. And I think the devil's biggest lie to you guys want to hear it? That you have time, right? I think so many of us are like, well, I'm young. When I get older and when I get closer to death, then I'll try to figure out this whole religion thing and faith thing, and then hopefully I'll make it to heaven. But guess what? Tomorrow's never promised. I can think of five personal friends that I know right now that I went to college with and I went to high school with, and they are no longer with me. It was just a couple months ago, the 3-year anniversary of my best friend in high school passed away. And I just remember like a little bit ago when we used to have all the sleepovers and we were talking about our 10-year plan. Like, I can't wait to do this, and I can't wait to have 4 kids. I can't wait to see what my wife's like. And he went down the wrong road and ended up dying from an overdose at the age of 22. See, tomorrow's never promised. We think it is, and the devil tries to lie to us. You don't have to be urgent. You don't have to care about your faith. You can worry about that later, right, when you get closer to the end. But time flies, right? It feels like we were just in sixth grade the other day. Some of you seniors, it probably feels like it was just the other day. We have to be urgent. We have to be urgent like five bags. That's what he was like. He's like, God is investing in me. I'm going to go to work for that. I'm going to do things for God right now. And I think we are so quick to not do things for God, one, because of time, and the other one, I just think, I don't know what it is, we just maybe don't see the value, or we can't see the value of God. We don't think he's worth our time. And I want to ask you guys this question. Why are we so urgent to put our time and resources in everything else but God, when God's the most valuable thing in all the world? Right? I want to give you guys this little illustration. I got this $100 bill. See that? Big Ben. Okay? And if I was to ask the question, how many of you guys will run up to this stage and do 100 push-ups for this $100 bill? Right? Look at all these hands. How many? You 100 push-ups? I'm not going to make you guys do it. But look at all those hands go up, okay? So I have this $100 bill, a lot of value. I have this penny right here. How many of you guys will come up here and do 100 push-ups for this penny? Yeah, you guys are just raising your hand now. Not many people will come up and do 100 push-ups for this penny. I think you guys are liars. Come on, don't be lying. We're in church. But that's what we do, you guys. We're missing the point, okay? This is what we should be going after, right? The $100. God, he is so much more valuable compared to this penny, okay? He's so much more valuable compared to a girlfriend. He's so much more valuable compared to a video game. He's so much more valuable than even a friendship with another human, with another person. He's so much more valuable than anything in this world, right? But here's what we do. We take this $100 bill. We have God, but we hide him. We have something that's way more valuable than this penny, but we flaunt this penny around. And when people look at our Instagrams and look at our lives, we're flaunting, oh, I'm all conference in this sport. That's going to pass away someday. I have all this money. I have this job. That's going to pass away someday. Right? I have a 4.0 GPA. Well, guess what? That's going to pass away someday. I'm not saying those things are bad, but I'm saying we need to work for these things before we work for this. And we need to be showing this around and being like, look at my God, look how valuable he is. Look how awesome my God is, right? He's way more valuable than anything in the world. And we got to start seeing that. I think we've missed that. We've had it backwards. We're valuing the wrong things. Second lesson, everyone say second. Come on, second lesson we learn from two bags. Everyone say two bags. Look to your neighbor and say two bags. Come on, you guys are getting hyped. Second lesson talking about two bags. You know what's up. Second lesson is that we have to own our situation. Okay, we got to own our situation. I love just diving into scripture. And when you just really read the verse over time and time again, it really speaks life to you. I love it says in verse 14, it says, again, it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to him. Do we have any quarterbacks in here? Anyone play quarterback? Anyone just play a volleyball? Mark, how about volleyball? Right, you guys come into a huddle, you bring in the huddle, and I love this verse. I see it as like the master or God is bringing in this huddle, and he sees people's capabilities. Some people are just more capable. Some people are better at volleyball than other people are. Some people are better at basketball than other people are. And he huddles these men up, and he goes, all right, I'm going to give you five bags. I'm going to give you two bags, and I'm going to give you one bag. And what I love about two bags is that he wasn't upset about this guy getting more, right? And I think we get so upset with the time and resources God gifted us. God, thank you for this time and resources. But then we start looking around at other people and like, man, they just have more. Man, their parents are married. My parents aren't. Man, they have a nice car and they got a nice house. And we start comparing and we start getting insecure and we start getting offended. But what I love about two bags is that he just owned up to what was in his hand. I want you guys to write this down if you're taking notes. God doesn't judge the hand you were dealt, but he will judge what's in your hand. He'll judge what you're dealt with. See, when we read this parable, I want to go back to it really quick. Did he favor five bags for bringing back five more? Did he favor him for giving five more than two bags did? Two bags only brought two more back to God. He didn't. He said, you guys are both equally successful. Both equally successful. So what we need to do is own our situation. We can't be like, man, God, why am I cleaning bathrooms while they get to preach? God, why am I downstairs in city kids wiping boogers while people get to lead worship? See, we just have to own whatever we're doing, sell out to it, kind of like what I was with all my two front teeth. Just own your circumstances, own your situation, and God will find you faithful, and God will say you're successful, and he says you get to enjoy the happiness of me. Come on, everyone say amen to that. All right, everyone look to your neighbor and say, third lesson. Come on, third lesson we learn is from one bag. That's what his name is. I'm just kidding, that's not his name. I don't know what his name is, but we're going to call him one bag. And we're going to read out of Matthew 25 again, and we're going to continue after verse 24. Who's with me? Oh, come on, we got Maddie in her Bible. I love it. We're going to verse 24. Check out the jumbled Bible behind me. It says, then the man who had received one bag of gold came. Master, he said, I knew that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your gold. Everyone say, hid your gold in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you. His master replied, you wicked, lazy servant. Whoa, jeez, I thought Jesus was nice. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. Well, then you should have put money on deposit with the bankers so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest. So take the bag of gold from him. Take it from one bag and give it to the one that has 10 bags. For whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. At this time, if we can have someone jump on the keys as I wrap up here. But you guys, our third and final point is that we cannot hide the things of God, right? We just talked about the $100 bill. We talked about the penny. God is the most valuable thing, and we want to show him that we value the time he's given us here on earth. We value the body he gave us. We value the family, even though it may be broken and messed up and jacked up like mine. I love them to death. We're going to own that. But we're not going to hide what God has given us. We're going to work for him. So I read these verses, and this is what comes to my head. God isn't looking for storage, but he's looking for courage. He's looking for those to step up in uncomfortable situations, step up at hard times. Okay? He's not looking for us to store. Just think about storage for a second. When we store things, right, what does that mean? What does that mean? I mean, can you think about the time that you've given someone a great gift and you've just like went all out on that gift and like, man, they're gonna love it. And you find it a couple days later in their closet, stored away. Or even worse, you find it in their storage locker. Usually what that means, when there's something in storage, that person doesn't find it useful, they don't find it important, and they don't value it. It's usually what that means. What does it mean when you're showing people things, and when you have stuff out in front, your Instagram, whatever it may be, when you get a new pair of shoes, right? You want to put them on. You want everyone to see them. You want people to value them, and you want people to see that you value them yourself. Right? I think you can instantly go on someone's social media, you can instantly go on someone's YouTube page or Instagram or Snapchat, and you can see what they value because it's visible. What we love, we put out in front of people. My bottom line for you guys tonight is this. Your faith isn't valuable to you if it is not visible to others. Come on, write that down. Your faith isn't valuable to you if it is not visible to others. See, so many of us are like one bag. We're just going to hide it away. God, I'm going to go to a couple Wednesdays, and I'm going to get my fixing. I'm going to come for a month or two, and I'm good. I don't need any more God. I'll put it in my pocket, my $100 bill, the most valuable thing in the entire world. I'll hide it, and I'll brag about my penny. right? And that's what we do. We hide what God has done. We hide God. And we say, oh, you know, my friend's going through a bad day. I'm not going to pray for him in the halls in front of all my peers. Nah, I'm going to hide him. And see, when we do this, when we bury the things God has given us, we are telling God and those around us that our faith is invaluable. God, you're not useful. It's not useful to me and not important. That's what we do when we store things away. That's what one bag's did, and God doesn't appreciate that. You can read the end of those verses to yourself. Doesn't look good for one bag. So just like Justin Bieber wouldn't be successful without his vocal coach, just like any successful person that's in your head right now wouldn't be successful without their mentor or coach, a faith that doesn't value God's coaching, that doesn't value God's gifts and times and resources, and we don't put it out in the forefront of people, and it's not at the forefront of our social media, well, then it means nothing. It will not be successful. And I want to shout out two people, and I know I could shout out many people in here because you guys are awesome and you're all killing it, and I just love each and every one of you. But I don't even know if he's here today because I think he's got some sports going on. But Cooper Fernelius, who knows him? Come on, sixth graders, you might know him. Ty, you know Cooper. Cooper Fernelius, a little sixth grader, his very first year in City Youth here. Since the back-to-school bash, he has brought about 50 to 20 friends from his basketball team and baseball team. Come on. He's not hiding God. He knows the value of God. He knows what counts. He knows what matters, and he knows tomorrow's not promised. He's going to work for the things of God. Guess what? He started the first ever faith club. I don't know, maybe in a long time. Maybe they've had one before, but it's been a long time at Farmington Middle. Come on, Farmington. He started, it's a little sixth grader. And four of those boys that started, I don't know, Ty, are you in that faith club? Ty's in it. Come on. There's four Southland City Youthers that started it, and there's one Hosanna kid. Come on, that's awesome. I love it. Cooper is killing it. I would bring him up on the stage, but he's not here. He's not hiding the things of God. He's putting in the work. He's putting in the time and resources. He's showing God, hey, I think you're valuable. I love the advice you're giving me. Thank you for this body. Thank you for my breath, every single breath. I'm going to put it into work. Second person, Maddie Dibble, stand up. Come on. You can sit back down. This is Maddie Dibble, as you can see. You may have seen her in the rap video dancing, but Maddie Dibble has just been crushing it since her OKC mission trip. Just absolutely crushing it. She's on her senior year, and she could just start floating and being lazy in her faith in her senior year, but no, she stepped it up to a whole nother level. Maddie Dibble, you are absolutely killing it in your faith. You are not scared of the things of God. You are not hiding anything of God. You know what Maddie Dibble did? Well, first of all, Maddie's always showing people on our social media, always talking about City Youth, always inviting people to her faith clubs and all this kind of stuff. But she was texting me this long message. She's like, I just really want to start putting posters all over the school about God and about see you at the poll. Do you think my school would be mad at me for that? I'm like, who cares? Just do it. And so she started doing it. She started see you at the poll. You guys are doing, is it once a month? She's doing once a month see you at the poll. She's not just doing it that one time a year. She started it once a month at her school. We can give it up one more time for Maddie Dibble. She's not hiding it. She's not scared. She's stepping out in her faith. I love it, you guys. We can look up to people like Maddie and Cooper that we could continue. A lot of you guys are killing it. Keep doing what you're doing. At this moment, I want all heads bowed, all eyes closed as we pray over this message, you guys. I believe that God is about to bust the lid off the time and resources you guys have. Dear God, I just thank you for every single student in this room. God, I thank you for your love. I thank you for your grace, God. It's all from you. I thank you for the money you have gifted them, the parents you have gifted them, God, the schools you have gifted them, the resources, the time that they're even alive, God, thank you. I pray that they would start seeing the value in you, God, that they would be urgent to work for you. They wouldn't be urgent to work for other things that don't add up and don't have as much value as you, God. God, I just pray that you would forever change them the way that they look at their time, the way that they look at the resources, and the way that they look at you and the way you invest in them, that they would equally invest back into you. Jesus, I thank you. We love you. We praise you, and we all say amen.